On October 5th, 1991, I was there.
In the final series of the 1982 season, the Dodgers and Giants were in a tight three-team race with the Atlanta Braves for the National League Western Division. The Dodgers and Giants had one final three-game series at Candlestick Park to try and catch the Braves. The Dodgers eliminated the Giants from the race with a 15-2 hammering in the second game of that series. The next day, on the last day of the season, Joe Morgan ripped a three-run homer to right off of Terry Forrester in the bottom of the seventh. That would give the Giants the lead, and they would go on to win 5-2, thus making sure the Dodgers went down with them. The Braves would win the NL West and get swept by the St. Louis Cardinals in the NLCS. Fast forward 9 years and 2 days later. For all of the second half of the 1991 season, the NL West race was a two-horse race between the Dodgers and, well, what do you know, the Braves. The Dodgers would have to try to keep their playoff hopes alive by making a trip to the stick and facing the Giants. To all the Dodger fans watching this, don't worry. I'll give you guys a moment when the Dodgers wrecked the Giants season later on. In almost every sport in every league, I have that one team that I'll get behind, thick and thin. I won't be hesitant to be a smug jerk at times when they win a championship. It's been going almost 30 years as a Giants fan. In almost every sport in every league, I'll have a side team. Why? Because I can. Who do I go for when the side team plays the favorite? Well, the favorite, duh. In the early 1990s, the baseball side team I had at that time was the Atlanta Braves. This story takes place in the days where I first started getting the superstation WTBS out of Atlanta in my home in California. Before TBS became a channel that aired Seth MacFarlane shows on a continuous loop and a Christmas story literally all day in December, TBS aired really old movies, really old TV shows, Atlanta Hawks basketball, and was the TV home of the Atlanta Braves. One of the voices I remember well in those days calling Braves games was the late Skip Carey, son of legendary Chicago Cubs broadcaster Harry Carey. When I wasn't watching and rooting for the Giants because I saw mostly Giants road games on KTVU, I'd be watching the Braves to get my TV baseball fix. TBS showed the Braves whether they were on the road or playing at the old Atlanta Fulton County Stadium or even in the old Turner Field in the late 90s up to 2007 when TBS no longer would be the Braves' TV home. In 1990, when I started watching the Braves, they were an abysmal boat wreck, finishing with the worst record in baseball. In that season, their manager Russ Nixon was fired in midseason, and this is when the Bobby Cox era would begin in Atlanta. Cox would manage the Braves until the 2010 season after losing another playoff series to the Giants. In the 1990 season, Cox was also the general manager of the Braves until he was replaced by John Schierholz a week after the 1990 season ended. In 1991, they were a pretty good team. Part of their pitching rotation featured future Hall of Famers in John Smoltz and Tom Glavine. Great things were yet to come for the 1990 NL Rookie of the Year, David Justice. The Braves would be in playoff contention for pretty much the whole season. I even went to the stick with my dad to watch the Giants host and beat the Braves in June of that season. While the Braves were stunning the baseball world with their amazing season after finishing in the basement a year earlier, the Dodgers were looking to build off their decent season in 1990, which had them finishing second behind the eventual world champion Cincinnati Reds. They got a base-stealing threat by poaching Brett Butler from the Giants. They also got Gary Carter, who played the 1990 season with the Giants as well. Carter would be reunited with a teammate from the 1986 World Series winning Mets team. The Dodgers' huge free agent signing in the offseason was the 1983 National League Rookie of the Year and 8-time All-Star, Darryl Strawberry. With the Giants completely out of the picture by season's end, I was giving full support to this new side team. I was learning how a pennant race worked and tuning into Braves games on TV and getting swept up in this interesting chase. The last weekend series was coming. I would be visiting my dad that weekend, and he had tickets for the second game of the series. While the Giants were looking to play spoiler again, across the country, the Braves were at home against the Houston Astros. The Astros, like the Braves a year earlier, were the worst team in the National League. The Braves and Dodgers were tied atop the NL West going into the weekend series. If both teams took care of business and swept their mediocre opponents, there would be a possibility of a one-game playoff for the Western Division. The Braves did their part, beating the Astros was 5-2. The Dodgers, on the other hand, 'twas a different story. Will Clark and Matt Williams took the 1991 Dodger All-Star pitcher Ramon Martinez deep en route to a 4-1 win over the Dodgers. The lead for the Braves was one game. The Braves' magic number was 2, meaning a Braves win and a Dodgers loss meant that the race was over. Before the game began, however, the fans of Candlestick Park were treated to a ceremony, and I was happy to see the guest of honor in person. Whether you've been a fan of the team since 1989 like myself, or in 2009 before the winning began, many Giants fans are familiar with the story of pitcher Dave Dravecki. Dravecki was traded to the Giants in 1987 and was one of the starters when the Giants played in the NLCS that year. He had a cancerous tumor removed from his pitching arm in 1988 and tried to play again in 1989. After he broke his arm celebrating the Giants going to their first World Series in 27 years, there was a malignant tumor found in an x-ray after the break. He would retire from baseball after the 1989 season, and his pitching arm and his shoulder would be amputated in 1991. 4 months after Dravecki had his amputation, the Giants would hold Dave Dravecki Day at the stick. I could speak for the 42,000 in attendance that it was an amazing moment. All the fans were on their feet as Dravecki walked out on that field. I continued to applaud as I watched the festivities. Dravecki was one of those Giants players I still admire up until this very day because of the testimony he has built after suffering a Giant setback, no pun intended, that would cut his career short. The starting pitchers in this game were two pitchers who had decent seasons for their teams in the 1991 season. For the Dodgers, Mike Morgan. Morgan had a 14-9 record going into this game and played in the All-Star game that year. He was the number 2 starter after Martinez. For the Giants, Trevor Wilson was having his best season in his major league career, 12-11 going into this game. Wilson's last outing was a week earlier against the Dodgers, picking up the W in a 4-1 win at Dodger Stadium. It was a pitcher's duel for the most part. The first three innings were scoreless. In the top of the fourth, Wilson retired the 4-5-6 hitters in order. The bottom of the fourth was when the game changed. With one out, Will Clark hits a triple to right. Next up, Matt Williams. Williams lines a single to left center, and it puts the Giants on the board as Clark is driven in. The fifth inning was quiet as both the Dodgers and Giants went down in order. Meanwhile, over at Fulton County Stadium, the Braves shaved the magic number down to 1 with a 5-2 win over the Astros. In between innings, the highlights of the game were shown on the Candlestick Jumbotron. When word got out that the Braves won, the crowd, mainly the Giants fans, went bonkers. Braves players and their fans would be locked in their own impromptu viewing party as they watched the same game I was at. Trevor Wilson continued to keep the Dodgers at bay with another 1-2-3 inning in the top of the 6th. Bottom of the 6th is when the Giants made it even harder for the Dodgers to avoid elimination. With one out, Willie McGee hit a line drive up the middle for a single. McGee was still second with Clark up at the plate. After McGee reached second, Clark was given a free pass to first. Next up, Williams hit a floater that dropped in past Lenny Harris to shallow left. McGee would score while Williams laid it out for a double. Clark was now on third. Kevin Bass would be intentionally walked to load the bases, and stepping up would be Robbie Thompson. Thompson would fly out to left for the second out. Simple sacrifice fly, however, turning to a disaster that would cost the Dodgers dearly. While Clark was tagging up the score and testing the arm of Cal Daniels, Daniels ended up throwing the ball past Gary Carter to the backstop. That would give Williams the green light to try and score. Due to a throwing error, one run turned into 2. With the Dodgers down by 4, they were running out of time. Wilson continued to keep the Dodgers off the board with a perfect 7th inning. The Dodgers had a fighting chance when Morgan struck out the side in the 7th. In the 8th, the Dodgers would be emptying their bench with 2 pinch hitters. Nothing changed, and the Dodgers went down in order again. By the top of the 9th, Giants fans were getting ready for some vicarious celebrating. Giants fans, myself included, were chanting the usual and doing the tomahawk chop. Trevor Wilson would stay in to pitch the 9th and try to get the complete game shutout and help deliver the finishing blow to the Dodgers' playoff hopes. Wilson struck out Butler to open the inning. Mike Sharperson hit a double to left center to start the rally. The next batter, struck out swinging. It was up to the legendary slugger Eddie Murray. Murray would ground to second, a classic Thompson to Clark moment. Ball game over. The fans went wild, as if the Giants were the ones who won the NL West. On the Tron, we would see the reaction from Fulton County Stadium after the final out was made. The Braves players celebrated knowing that they would be going to the playoffs for the first time since 1982. I would enjoy the side team wild ride until Game 7 of the 1991 World Series. The Braves, up 3-2 on the Minnesota Twins, were unable to to win the fourth game at Ye Olde Metrodome. This would begin the long stretch of the Atlanta Braves playing in October every single year up to 2006. For the 1992 season, I would continue to keep the Braves as a side team, and I wouldn't mind at all. The Giants were having a mediocre season, and there was a possibility of the team moving to St. Petersburg, Florida the next season looming over the head of the franchise. The Braves beat the Pirates for the second consecutive year in the NLCS in dramatic Game 7 fashion. It would come up short once again, this time to the Toronto Blue Jays. Jays made history, becoming the first Canadian team to win the World Series. The 1993 season was around the corner. Time for another lousy season for the Giants, and maybe the Braves can try it again. This is where the side team would get thrown aside. Someone told me in high school, never root for the division rival of your favorite team. Braves added another future Hall of Famer to the rotation, signing free agent pitcher Greg Maddux in the offseason. They also made a trade to bolster their lineup at the trade deadline by acquiring Fred McGriff from the San Diego Padres. The Giants avoided the fate of relocating to Florida thanks to an 11th hour sale of the team to Peter McGowan and the National League approving the sale to keep the Giants in San Francisco. On top of that, the team got some upgrades. Roger Craig stepped down as Giants manager after the 1992 season. Dusty Baker would be the new skipper for the team. The Giants also got a new general manager in Bob Quinn Sr. They also found a replacement to fill the hole in left field after Kevin Mitchell left. He was someone I rooted hard against for two NLCS series in 1991 and 1992. Barry Bonds. From May until September, the Giants had a stranglehold on the NL West lead. Like in 1991, it was a two-team race for the NL West, my favorite team and the side team. The Houston Astros were the only team that got close. If you call 16 and a half games out of first place by my 16th birthday, close. Then one 8-game losing streak in September, and it started to fall apart. Thanks to a perfectly timed winning streak going into the last series of the season, both the Giants and Braves were tied atop the NL West. The Braves would host the expansion Colorado Rockies, the Giants would have to make the trip to Chavez Ravine and face the Dodgers for a 4-game set. It would come down to the last day of the season. Early that day, the Braves took care of their end, sweeping the Rockies with a 5-3 win. The Giants needed to complete the 4-game sweep of the Dodgers to force a 1-game playoff for the NL West. This is when the Dodgers would exact revenge for the game I was at 2 years earlier. The game was going smoothly until the 5th inning, despite the Giants trailing 3-1. Dave Burba took the hill in the bottom of the 5th, and the wheels came off. The Giants gave up 3 runs in the 5th. Another run in the 6th. Then in the bottom of the 8th, this remarkable season would end in a whimper as the Dodgers hung 5 more runs. The Dodgers threw the Giants in a shallow grave and poured cement on them after a 12-1 slaughter. The Giants won 103 games and would be sitting at home in October. The side marriage was over. I shoved my Braves hat in the corner of my closet and no longer wore it. I hated the Braves with a fiery passion and enjoyed watching them lose the NLCS to the Phillies in 1993. Watching the Giants beat the Braves in the NLDS in 2002 and 2010, the salt finally went away. Hey, I even got a hat again. While I was watching the 2010 NLDS between the Giants and Braves, I felt a bit of nostalgia within me. A Braves game on TBS, like the good old days, when I would watch the pennant races of this team in the early 90s. On an unrelated note to the story, many hours later, after the Dodgers got eliminated, just down the road at the Cow Palace, a new era of sports in the Bay Area was about to begin.
But on that afternoon at the Stick, everyone was a Braves fan for a day. The Braves were everybody's side team, and I was there in all of it on October 5th, 1991.